he can't sell a fight pay-per-view by himself. What he needs is for another big champion to bless him with the opportunity of fighting him so that finally he can fight a pay-per-view. Going to have to beg for like a Tank Davis or even a Ryan Garcia at 140 to bless him with the opportunity to finally step up and fight in a pay-per-view.
Not yet, most definitely. You got a guy who hasn't even looked at a card in over a year now, Guenzhen Cao, looking shredded, the most shredded I've ever seen him. He gave out his heart out. There were times, especially 11th and the 12th, got hit at the sound of the bell, and he just kind of stood there. And the ref just kind of looked at him, and he just kind of like motioned him to like start walking to his corner. You can tell his legs were a little bit shaky, wobbly. He fought his heart out.
Because no one likes Bobo. I feel like I'm under the impression no one really likes him. No one really paid attention to
I'll
him.
be honest, I don't like him. I don't respect him.
That's the thing. He's been calling for big fights. He's been saying, "Oh, everyone's ducking me, this and that." Yet his resume is dry. So this is his first and maybe his only shot at a big showdown, and it's against the Mexican monster. So if anything, he has everything to gain. You know, he needs this fight in order to maybe. Welcome back, guys, to another episode of the Last Round Podcast. You got me, Pablo.
You got me, Rudo.
You got me, Asa.
And let's talk boxing. So let's dive right into it to Thursday night's Las Vegas showdown for the WBC belt at lightweight, the vacant one between Shakur Stevenson versus Edwin de los Santos. Now, this fight, besides the fight, aside from that, social media has had a lot to say about this bout between these two fighters. And let's say, it was not a very good reception that this fight got, very, very highly talked about on Thursday night. And I was wondering, what were you guys' thoughts about Shakur Stevenson's performance and the fight overall?
Yeah, the fight, man, it under-delivered big time, especially in a venue like Las Vegas with the F1 weekend looming. It was completely horrible performance for boxing, for a boxing event. Shakur Stevenson decided, you know what, I'm just going to run this entire fight. He said, it's not worth it to let Edwin de los Santos, a guy who's very explosive, has a lot of speed, he's very fast. And he can really go from 0 to 100 really quickly. I guess Shakur Stevenson, didn't like his chances counterattacking him, so he decided, I'm just gonna get on my bike. I'm barely gonna throw any punches, and I'm just gonna run the whole time. So.
I wish I had a comment, but I sadly fell asleep out of there the fifth round, so I wasn't really quite sure. But no, fight definitely under-delivered. Expecting a lot more. As I said before in the last episode, is that Shakur not only he has to win, but he has to win dominantly in a way that makes the fans want to come back to see another Shakur fight.
Put on an entertaining show.
Put on an entertaining show, you know what I'm saying? Even if your boxing isn't really catered that night, the game plan is just to kind of be on the legs more, be more on the being super defensive, come out like you know how Mayweather had some of those spectacular ring entrances and stuff like that. I remember one time he came in a Roman gladiator stuff suit, and he had like girls carrying him and stuff like that. That's entertaining, you know what I'm saying? And then Mayweather would go and give not the best worthy entertaining boxing show or whatever, but he understood that aspect of being entertaining and stuff like that. And Shakur couldn't even deliver on that, really.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I feel like a lot of people are definitely not happy. I knew some people, some clips that I saw on X, a lot of people were leaving the arena like by the eighth, ninth round.
Yeah, it's show business at the end of the day.
Yeah.
So maybe Shakur should have been, conscious of this. Maybe I'm gonna take this fight really, really safe and cautiously. Okay, maybe try to bring another aspect of entertainment to the event. Just like you said, maybe a very spectacular ring entrance or, maybe talking shit in the middle of the fight or doing something, man. Just like making it an impression on the crowd, which is something that he completely failed in. I think the fight can be summed up with the basic CompuBox statistic. No fighter landed double digits in any single round. That's atrocious, man. Like that's really rare for something like that to happen. And I think it just really shows that the Shakur Stevenson really did not want to fight there. He just wanted to get a very, very easy win, run around, and not let Edwin de los Santos, someone who could potentially be dangerous, land a punch on him.
Here, I have a question for you guys. Would you guys rather be an email champ and become champion that way, or would you rather become champion the way Shakur Stevenson became champion on Thursday?
Wow, that's a crazy one right there. I'm gonna be honest. You know, I would rather be an email champion, because that performance. I mean, like you said, people are cooking him on X. Mm. I don't know, Ray Jackson, a very big figure on X, tweeted out saying Shakur got to get off X for the next 2 days because. The next year, because the last 2 days they've just been cooking him nonstop. They've been cooking him in. I mean, I think it's well deserved. I mean, you should talk shit after that performance. So, you know, I'm an email champion. You know, you guys can talk shit about me. Hey, I'm still a world champion.
You know what's interesting though is that a lot of people, you know, I think it's better to become an email champion because you still get criticism, but it'd be less criticism. You know what I'm saying? By now, we have completely forgotten that Boots is now an email champion.
Yeah, maybe a little hype in on X for like a day or two, but with this Shakur, oh, they're gonna be talking about that for a while.
Yeah, so going to your question, I think maybe an emo champion, just so the criticism isn't too much.
I think also with the emo champion, I mean, at the end of the day, it's really the organization's fault. You know what I'm saying? They're the ones that are sending out the belts via email, typing up congratulations, you're a WBC champion now. It's like, okay. But you know, so
yeah. But back to the fight, though. What's it called? You know, one of the things I came or to the conclusion of after Thursday night's showdown was that Shakur Stevenson, you cannot deny his skills. You know, inside the ring, he showed, you know, his sidestep. You know, his movement overall was pretty good, you know. But like you said, you have to show some type of entertainment factor. And that's what he didn't deliver. And that's why it's going to be very, very hard for him, or very difficult for him to become a pay-per-view star. Because people will not want to pay $50, $60, $75, $85 for a pay-per-view if Shakur Stevenson's going to be fighting like that. People want to get their money's worth, not only by buying pay-per-views, but by going to the arena and watching them fight live. So for me, Shakur Stevenson took a big hit to his stock. In the aspect of business-wise, you know, entertainment value, his stock really decreased. And I believe he's well aware of this. You know, he kind of mentioned in the post-fight interview that he wasn't very happy about his performance. And then he started saying, you know, no excuses, but then ended up coming out on X and kind of coming out with some excuses while deleting the same tweets. But regardless of that, Shakur Stevenson and his team have to realize that if you're going to box that way, okay. But keep in mind that people are not going to like it, and you're going to take a big hit in your pay-per-view status.
I mean, it's true. I mean, the whole boxing community now knows it. Even before, like, yeah, I think now it's really fresh in people's minds, and people are like, come to a consensus that, yes, Shakur Stevenson is super boring. But even before, a clip of Rolly is going viral right now.
It was an older interview.
Old interview, yeah. And what he said was completely facts. He went on to say, you know, Shakur is a boring fighter and he will not be a pay-per-view star. Listen, Shakur Stevenson is a three-division world champion. He's in the top level of boxing-wise, you know what I'm saying? But he's never had a pay-per-view. If he ever does have one, he's going to struggle. So he needs another boxing superstar to bless him, to give him the opportunity to actually put on a boxing event that is worthy of pay-per-view and that people will actually want to, you know, tune into. Mm-hmm. By himself, he can't do it. And he's a three-division world champion. That goes to show that this man, like, yes, you have great boxing skills, but it's a show business. And in show business aspect, you are failing.
Yeah, and, you know, as I said last week, you have to bring another element to whatever you bring. You bring, you know, the fighting skills. You got the skills. That's great, but you also have to combine it to, in a sense, so the casual viewer, the casual person, will actually want to pull out their wallet, pull out their card out of the wallet and actually pay for it. But maybe, do you guys believe when he said that he had sustained an injury? Does the criticism lessen a little bit for you guys.
Did he say specifically an injury? Did he just say like he wasn't feeling his best?
Bob Arum has said that he was injured, and they were trying to get him to do a couple tests. They did a couple tests. He said also on Twitter saying that he wasn't 100%, but no excuses. Anything specific or just nothing like specific, injury? But something just an injury.
Man, I mean, I don't believe it. I don't really buy it. I mean, he still showed, you know, his defense was, his reflexes were on point. So it's not like he had like a flu or something. You know, he looked very active in there. It's just, he just didn't throw punches. If he says his fist like hurt or something, maybe, but I still don't believe it.
Yeah, I find that a little harder to believe. I don't think he would have had that same, you know, he would have made that same comment if he would have won, like, decisively, you know, a very good performance. I don't believe he would have said that. But, yeah, regardless of that, I don't believe he should pin it on any excuse. He's well aware of what boxing wants to see, especially with all these fights, and especially for him. Like you said, he's a 3-division world champion, has never had a pay-per-view. And for someone who's been a champion in 3 different divisions, who's a big name in the sport, who many consider even top 10 pound for pound, he needs to know that he needs to put something out of value that makes the people want to watch him. But I believe on Thursday night, the fight of the night, though, was the Navarrete. Navarrete Consensual, that's the fight that should have been the main event over Shakur Stevenson and De Los Santos. Now, that's the thing that is a little irritating when it comes to boxing, the fact that you sometimes have such an action-packed fight followed by an absolute snooze fest like the Shakur. So, and also on a Thursday night as well, it was, I think overall Top Rank took a very big L on Thursday with what happened between the main event, the timing of the entire event and stuff like that. But it's boxing, you know. I guess Shakur can only try to learn from this, in my opinion.
Yeah, one other thing I'd like to say about Shakur. Some people, like his supporters and his fans, and I'll get into this, Floyd's supporters and his fans, they've all been saying, or some of them, this is a minority, right? But, you know, the minority sometimes speaks very loud. They're saying, oh, this is boxing. You guys don't understand the sweet science. You guys just want to see a brawl like Navarrete or something. You guys can't appreciate, you know, the sweet science of boxing. And I have a bone to pick with that. Because okay, it's like, okay, they say boxing. What is boxing? Boxing is the art of hit and not get hit. It's not just not get hit. That's what Shakur was doing last night. Like we said, he landed under 10 punches every single round. He was barely throwing. And especially at the very beginning of the fight, he wasn't throwing anything at all. His full focus was on defense. So he didn't complete the boxing, what boxing is, which is hit and not get hit. He completed half of it, not get hit. And that's why it's running. It's not boxing because he wasn't hitting. He wasn't punching back.
Yeah, I guess, again, going back to what we're talking about, Shakur not delivering, only doing 50% of the other half, which is actually landing a punch, or maybe something even more than just a jab, you know, throw a little right hand in there since you are a southpaw and stuff like that, or even a hook, you know what I'm saying, throw something. But yeah, this is not looking good. You know, Shakur is now a 3-time world division champ in 3 different weight classes, and yet his stock took a significant blow to this. Where does he go from here now?
Go ahead.
No, you go.
Okay, so.
No, I'll go. No, yeah, you go.
I mean, it's hard to say, because obviously, you know, like we said, he's not the top level boxing-wise. He's a 3-division world champion. Very few fighters can achieve something like that, right? So I don't see him pulling off a, you know, Manny Pacquiao where he starts going up heavy divisions and winning world champions. So what the thing with him is, he can't sell a fight pay-per-view by himself, even a big he just can't sell it by himself. So what he needs is for another big champion to bless him with the opportunity of fighting him, so that finally he can fight a pay-per-view, because I think that's what's next. Kind of like in the aspect of boxers, you know, they get better, they win world championships, and then they start making, you know, boxing events, a whole atmosphere, pay-per-view, you know, a lot of people in the arena. That's the complete opposite of Shakur. He can't do that. And he showed last night in the going into the future, a lot of people aren't going to trust him to do that alone. So if he wants that, if he wants to be a high ticket, high selling fighter, a prize fighter, you know, then he's going to have to beg for, you know, another top 135, or like a Tank Davis or even a Ryan Garcia at 140 to bless him with the opportunity to finally step up and fight in a pay-per-view arena.
Well, it doesn't even have to be, it has to be an exciting fighter, you know, a fighter that fans want to see. Would you guys say even a Pitbull against Shakur Stevenson would sell, you know, do good numbers, considering the fact that Pitbull not only brings in aggressive style, he's not that good, but he brings in aggressive, entertaining style, and he brings in the Mexican fans. Do you think that would, you know, be an alternative instead of, you know, fighting a Devin Haney, a Ryan Garcia, if he can't get those fights?
I don't know if that would be a pay-per-view.
Yeah, I wouldn't be paying $80, $85 to tune into Shakur versus Pitbull.
Yeah,
I understand what you're trying to get at, but yeah, just that, like, and even then, like, he still won't get any the investment of trying to do a pay-per-view with Pitbull isn't really going to pay off, because no one's going to want to tune into that. They would rather tune into, like, a Ryan Garcia versus Shakur, do a $75 pay-per-view, and then see if they could possibly get some type of reinvestment back into that. But, yeah, I mean, I think Shakur's stock has definitely hit a lot of these other guys. They know that Shakur is not only really good, but they're not going to get paid. It's the same thing with, like, Canelo. Canelo, when you fight Canelo, you're going to get a lot of money, but you might, you know, you might lose, but at least you might get a lot of money. It's the same thing with these other guys. Why would they fight Shakur? He's really good, but I'm not going to get paid that much, because even he's not a pay-per-view star. I think that's I think that's something that he just has to work on, really.
Yeah, I mean, it's just, he's just so low. Like, he just doesn't sell. Like, a Tank Davis against Pitbull, that could be a pay-per-view, because Tank Davis brings in fans.
Yeah.
He does his part. Shakur Stevens, he needs someone to literally carry him to the numbers. And a Tank Dave and a Pitbull Cruz, although that would be an entertaining fight, Pitbull also doesn't have a large enough fan base to carry them to a good pay-per-view numbers. So that's why I think the companies would be like, no, I'm not going to make this pay-per-view. I'm just going to lose money.
Yeah.
You know, like, it really makes no sense. So Shakur's in a very bad position right now, man. Like, no one's going to want to fight him, A, because he's good, but B, because they're also not going to get paid. They're not going to get pay-per-view points, you know, money, none of that. They're just going to get a very boring whooping for 12 rounds. What's the advantage of fighting him?
You know, we were bashing Shakur a lot, and rightfully so. You know, he didn't showcase his best on Thursday. But I do believe there's some blame to be put on Edwin de los Santos himself, because he could have also upped the pace, you know, upped the pressure, done more in the fight, but throughout most of the fight, he looked clueless. He looked like he did not know what to do, and I think some blame should be put on him as well for also failing to deliver, because based on CompuBox numbers, he only had 40 punches landed throughout the whole fight, which is the lowest punching output for a championship fight in CompuBox history.
World record.
Well, I think that's because of, I mean, that kind of goes to show, like, Shakur's running ability, honestly, because De Los Santos isn't a boring fighter. We've seen in his other fights. If you stand there in front of him, oh, he will most definitely throw punches at you. He is not scared to throw punches. The thing is, you can't just go crazy on a guy that's running like that. Like, Shakur Stevenson was doing an amazing job. His back step is really, like, amazing. Like, his reflexes are really on point. Edwin de los Santos is a very explosive guy, and he still couldn't land punches on him. So, in Edwin's mind, he's like, well, I'm not just going to, like, super overextend, try to land on this guy, because he doesn't even want to fight me. He's really just running away from me. So,
but, like, the fight was close in the aspect that no one was really throwing anything. Mm-hmm. And if you're in De Los Santos' corner, you should be well aware that, okay, these fight, you know, even though these rounds may be close and you may think that you're winning them, you're not. Because you're fighting Shakur Stevenson, the favorite, the promotion fighter. You know, he and his team needed to keep in mind that, yo, like, there is the high probability that we are losing this fight compared to how every single round was going. It was similar to the same. It was always the same. Every round looked the same as the previous one. So he should have done something more, in my opinion, to kind of instigate a fight, because there was moments, only a small handful of moments, where Shakur and De Los Santos actually exchanged, and every time they exchanged, Shakur would instantly start going back in his bike, because, you know, he felt the power, he felt the explosiveness from De Los Santos, and did not want to gamble on trying to continue exchanging with them. And if in De Los Santos' corner, they should have been aware that, hey, like, maybe we try to instigate this more. Yes, there's a high probability that we're gonna, you know, not come on top, but as long as we're able to make it a fight and give him something, you know, it gives us a better chance of even getting the win.
What's the thing? I mean, he's tried sometimes, you know, like, he'd, like, push the pace, but he'd...
apply the pressure,
yeah, for apply sure. The pressure, throw jabs, and, like try to go towards him. Shakur literally take massive leaps back, so De Los Santos doesn't even land on his gloves. Like, how are you, like, it's not smart to start lunging crazy and overreaching on a guy like Shakur, because eventually then Shakur would be like, okay, now I'm going to try to counter you. But Shakur wasn't even trying to counter. He was literally just trying to run, which was kind of insane to me.
Yeah, and I think it goes back to Edwin De Los Santos. I know, you know, that's a big criticism. You could say a valid critique, but I think Edwin is a tremendous fighter. Like, I think that's another thing that we also have to keep in mind. The reason why Shakur was running was because he was very aware, very concerned for his power and explosiveness and his speed as well. And he has somewhat decent, good boxing abilities that they were giving Shakur problems that even he wasn't going to try to see if he could actually, like, take the punch or see if he was actually about it. Shakur knew Edwin was about it, and so he just decided to be more defensive. And that's credit to Edwin, you know? I think that was the smartest thing, because I feel like if he were to try to start opening up a lot more, throwing more combinations, I think Shakur would have then just picked him apart. I think he did the best he could, I think.
Yeah, the thing is with it, yeah, that's probably true. Shakur, like, you know, Edwin is very explosive, and Shakur was like, why am I even going to bother trying to, you know, like, fight this guy? Like, he's too explosive. Okay, I'm just going to beat him very boring, you know, running all this stuff we're talking about. The thing is, yeah, Edwin Dos Santos is good, but he's not the best. He's not the best explosive fighter. He's not the best, you know, a offensive fighter. If Shakur is scared of the explosivity of Edwin Dos Santos, wait until he gets into the ring with the Tank Davis.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying? Like, they are some real killers at 135. And I'm not saying that De Los Santos isn't a real killer, but there's levels. You know, this was his first step up. There's people that have been at the top and that are as explosive, and if not more explosive than Edwin. And if Shakur can't handle that type of speed, he's going to have a massive problem when he fights someone like Tank Davis.
Yeah, and now going back to an ex-fighter that apparently ducked him. Like, how do you think Martin does against him? Do you think Martin is also within the same level of Tank?
Well, Martin is more of like
a boxer.
A boxer, yeah. Mm. He's not really a very explosive fighter. He doesn't really have that much knockout power either, does he? So, with that one, Frank Martin is, you know, he's a boxer, so he's going to try to box him. Well, he's not going to outbox Shakur.
Mm.
You know, Shakur is a master boxer. Master runner probably would be the right word after that fight. With Frank Martin, I mean, I think Frank Martin, I don't think would be able to beat him, just because he doesn't have the necessary skills. His style doesn't match up well with Shakur.
And that'd be one boring fight.
It would be very boring.
It'd be boring.
I was just thinking about it right now. I was like, damn, that should be boring. Yeah.
I believe the most boring fights would be the ones with Devin Haney, with Frank Martin, and, like, honestly, I still, look, what happened Thursday night happened, whatever. But we cannot deny Shakur has these skills. You know, he's still undoubtedly one of the best pound-for-pound fighters in the world. And I still believe he beats everyone at 135. However, the conversation between Tank and Shakur, between a possible fight between those two, now has me a little bit, you know, on the fence about that. Because beforehand, I was, you know, I thought Shakur would not, you know, walk over Tank, but I felt pretty confident that he'd beat him. But based on his last performance, based on how he looked, you know, it's got me on the fence about that. So I wanted to ask you guys, what would you guys predict for a Tank Davis versus Shakur Stevenson fight?
See, that would be a fight that Shakur finally would get a pay-per-view.
Yeah.
You know, if Tank blessed him, here you go, buddy. I will make you a star. You know, he should beg Davis, bro. Davis is the guy at 130. I mean, he sells out arenas, man. Anyway, so yeah, I said it before. I always thought that Tank Davis was actually better, and I thought he'd win. But I thought it would be a little closer of the fight. After seeing this performance by Shakur, it just reaffirmed it in my mind. I think Gervonta Tank Davis is the best at 135. And I think his explosivity would pose, his speed, his explosivity, his footwork would pose just too big of a problem for Shakur. That's his weakness, I guess. His weakness is like being explosive, because Shakur does not want to exchange with them, bro. He doesn't even want to let his hands go. He doesn't want to even give him the opportunity to like land a punch. He just wants to run away from fast fighters. So I got Gervonta Davis.
Yeah, definitely a fight I still want to see, unlike some of the other 135 pounders. The fight with him and Tank, that would definitely be a good fight. I definitely think Tank will definitely have the upper hand, really. And I just think one thing that he definitely has over Edwin is that he definitely knows how to pressure you in a very smart manner, an efficient manner, almost as if like slowly but surely, like stalking his prey, almost round by round, gassing you out with his pressure and stuff like that. And I'm not quite sure if Shakur is he's never faced anyone like him, and he doesn't have anything to stop someone like that. You know what I'm saying? So yeah, I just think I think Tank could probably stop him, Shakur, maybe in the later rounds for sure.
I think so, honestly, too, bro. If he lands one of those big haymaker, oh my gosh, it's not gonna go good for Shakur.
And I also think he has a little bit better boxing skills than Edwin as well. Mm-hmm. So he just combining these different things together, and I just think it's gonna be a nightmare for him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Gervonta's a mad versatile fighter. You know, he has everything. He's well-rounded. He has the footwork, he has the speed, the explosiveness, he has of course the power. Mm-hmm. And he has the boxing, you know, he has the IQ, he's smart in there. You know, back early Gervonta Davis, you would look at him, you were like, oh, he's just a puncher, you know. But as the years have gone by, he's really evolved his game, and he's downloads data just like Floyd, just like how these amazing boxers would do. They just download data, and then when he finds the right time, the right opportunity, then he just explodes and he catches you. Which is why, like you said, this would be a very dangerous fight for Shakur. Regardless, I still edge it for Shakur, man. I still edge it for Shakur. But it definitely really has me on the fence about it. It's more 50-50, in my opinion, now than it was like last week even for this fight.
Definitely. Going to a little of the co-main event. You know, we got the fight of the night. Honestly. And yeah. You know what? Going back to that, that's kind of crazy. I think it was the juxtaposition, man. Like, it was such a entertaining co-main event. And then for us to turn around into such a boring fight, that's what made it even worse.
Yeah. You know?
Like, maybe they should have just taken that one out, because maybe then we would have had, like, it wouldn't have been such a crazy turnaround, you know? Anyway, so we had a draw versus Navarrete and Consensual. Tough fight, you know. Yeah, tough fight, man. Yeah. And I think it goes to show you, yeah, I think a lot of people were downplaying Consensual a little bit, and he showed up and he showed out. He did his best, so he was able to get a draw. Close fight, man, though. Close. He got dropped three times.
Two times.
He got dropped twice and got hurt, wobbled a couple of times. But what'd you think of the fight?
Man, very exciting fight. Like we said before, we knew, I think you predicted it was going to be fight of the night, and most definitely. You got a guy who hasn't even looked at a carb in over a year now, Consensual, looking shredded, the most shredded I've ever seen him in a mega fight like this before. He gave out his heart out, you know what I'm saying? I think there were times, especially in the 11th and the 12th, I think specifically at the end of the 10th round, where he got hit right at the sound of the bell, and he just kind of stood there in the corner. And then the ref just kind of looked at him, and he just kind of like motioned him to like start walking to his corner. You can tell his legs were a little bit shaky, wobbly. Yeah, he fought his heart out. And he definitely gave Navarrete problems, like I said last time. I don't know why so many people were writing him off. He had... Not only does he have amateur experience, but he won an Olympic gold medal, He's also had other world title fights, so that's experience as well. And he's been at that weight class for a while now, and he has his boxing abilities are they're not bad, but they're not good either. They're just like he was just so smart that he was gonna be able to expose Navarrete and his weaknesses hella, and that's basically how the fight went. He really exposed Navarrete for his lack of boxing ability and stuff like that, and really brought it to light. And it took Navarrete, you know, that Mexican force in him to, you know, dog it out. And you know, that's what we got, the fight that we got, a all action 12 round fight.
Yeah, Navarrete is lucky he got that power, man. Because if he didn't have that power to drop or hurt him, then he would have lost the
They'd be a
fight.
new world champ.
Yeah, because Conceição definitely won the majority of the rounds. I mean, he got a draw even though getting dropped in two rounds. That's two 10-8s, you know? So, but he was able to come back because, like you said, he picked his moments. You know, he was doing a really good job. Whenever Navarrete would try to start immediately, he'd like shut him down with a very strong 1-2. He had a very strong 1-2. He's a strong guy, man. Yeah, he's a very strong guy, and he put a lot of problems on Navarrete. But Navarrete's his savior, man. His power, dude. Like that, it really came to light. Like, yeah, this guy got power, man. Like he dropped him. He hurt him several times. He probably could have stopped him. I think it was the 11th where like that he was like super unsteady. Conceição going back into the corner, he was very hurt. And I probably Navarrete, if he played it a little bit smarter, I think he could have stopped him. But yeah, he got saved. Definitely some stuff to work on with Navarrete, you know. But it's kind of like the old, same old stuff, you know. His defense, head movement, this and that. You know, we could just keep on going on and on.
His nutrition.
His nutrition, probably. Yes, they gave him a Twinkie before. Hopefully he didn't need it, man. Because man, hopefully he saved it for after the fight.
Now they're thinking the camera turned off.
See, that type of stuff is just like, come on, unprofessional, dude. Amateurish. Anyway, yeah, but I don't know about the draw though. What were you guys' thoughts about that? Because it was a close fight, but there was two knockdowns. Navarrete definitely did win some other rounds, but Conceição did, you know, have strong rounds of himself.
There was a lot of, I feel, toss-up rounds because, you know, Conceição would start off, you know, strong in the for opening round, or not even opening round, opening minutes of the rounds, but then Navarrete would get his, you know, the land the harder shots throughout the round, you know, even second half of the round. So it was very hard, you know, for the judges to kind of score it. I believe the draw was fair, honestly. I wouldn't have been mad if Navarrete would have won, or even if Conceição would have won. But I think the draw kind of you know, it kind of tells the story of the fight, and it also shows light of how the efforts of Conceição. You know, he's a dog. He's a straight dog. No one is able to take that much punishment from Navarrete and still keep on going. You know, that was he took punches. I know he probably woke up on Sunday with a bad headache, you know. On Friday, I mean. He woke up on Friday with a headache, you know, and felt his body was destroyed, sore, you know, bruised up, beaten up. But hey, the effort that he displayed on Thursday really, you know, even though he's already fought for a championship belt 3 times and he's fallen in every single one of those attempts, he could potentially get another shot because he's really showcased that he's got something that can trouble any champion at 130. And that's what I really liked about Conceição on Thursday night.
Yeah, I think it was fair. I think it was either a draw because thankful. I this is how I scored the fight. I scored the fight 7-5 or 6-6. 7-5 to Conceição. And I think the two judges scored it like that as well, because if you do like that, 7-5, which is 115, 113, those 2 points, those two 10-8 rounds, boom, they drop it to a draw. So I think that's what happened. You could have given 6-6, and I think that would have been fair as well. And with those scorecards, Navarrete would have pulled ahead just by a little bit because of those knockdowns. But I think all in all, it's fair, and then it kind of does give light to how close and action-packed that fight was.
I mean, I'm not mad about the decision, right? It was a draw, yes. But
Here comes the hater.
but I wasn't agreeing too much on the second knockdown. that knockdown, if I remember correctly, it almost seemed as though like he hit him on the shoulder, or not on the shoulder, but on the bicep, and it looked like Constancio just kind of fell down through, just exhausted and stuff like that. Robbery? But if that knockdown was actually legit, then I'm not mad. But just for my eyes in that instance, I was like, oh, they should really overturn that. But yeah, I would say I'm not mad about it.
Well, you're not a ref, so you don't know. Yeah. It was that one was a bit strange, you know. It wasn't. Yeah, it kind of landed it kind of like on the arm-ish. And then it seemed mainly more like it was just like the forward pressure of Navarrete kind of just pushed him off balance. But he got the knockdown and, you know, he got the 2 points.
Oh, yeah, so he came out with a draw. He seemed pretty happy about it, too. You know,
they both seemed happy.
They were pretty happy, yeah. But I believe Navarrete's corner was a bit more, you know, joyous to the fact that he was able to retain his belt, at least. Regardless, he stayed active, pretty active this year. Navarrete fought 3 times in 2023, and I'm sure he's thinking of hopefully unifying the division next year. With the new signing of Top Rank, Foster, you know, another champion at 130 who just coming off a stupendous comeback win a couple weeks back. So, with that signing, Top Rank had the potential to unify the 130 division with Navarrete versus Foster. How do you guys see that fight happening? And, yeah, what are you guys' thoughts about that?
I think Navarrete would win that one. I think Foster, he likes to brawl a little bit, you know. He likes to kind of come forward and, like, exchange. And I don't think he's as strong as Constancio. So, actually, I think Constancio might beat him, honestly. I think Navarrete definitely has that one in the bag against Foster.
Yeah, I think so, too. Although, again, it goes back, you know, at 130, it does seem as though, like, if the guys can somewhat take his punch or whatever, and they have somewhat decent boxing abilities, they can definitely expose some of the holes that Navarrete obviously has. I'm just thinking right now of Foster's performance when he fought
Rocky Hernandez?
No, the other guy. Vargas. Ray Vargas at, what was it, 126?
130.
He boxed beautifully against a guy who, although he's not much of a... He's not really much of a your typical Mexican come forward type of fighter. He's more like a counter puncher type thing. He comes from the cloth of Nacho Beristain, trained Juan Manuel Marquez, and I can't remember the other guy, the 106 pounder from back in the day as well. Kind of more like a counter punching type stuff like that. Laid back. He boxed beautifully against him. So I feel like if Foster does bring out that version of him, he could definitely give Navarrete some trouble, but I'm still sticking with my original plan or what I have for the 130 landscape. Navarrete, Foster, and then the other two can battle it out for third and fourth place, but for sure Navarrete will definitely come on top if they were to fight.
That's very interesting. But so that's what happened on Thursday night. You know what? I made 5 bets on DraftKings on the co-main event and the main event. And I got 4 out of 5, you know.
Bad.
Yeah, it's not bad.
Good day.
Yeah, the only one that messed me up was that I talked about it last week. I predicted Navarrete was going to stop Constancio. So when he didn't stop him, I was a bit, you know, disappointed. I was actually a little upset because I was like, that ruins my whole parlay.
Yeah.
But regardless, very, very just interesting Thursday night that we got. Which moves us forward over to the UK for the influencer side. Misfits 11 kicked off showcasing B Dave versus Jarvis, and Jarvis was making his Misfits debut, and based on the reaction from people, they were really pleased with him and they were actually very entertained. Now this was a very there was a fight at 155 for the vacant Misfits championship belt, and what were you guys' thoughts about this fight between B Dave and Jarvis?
Well, I mean, those first 5 seconds hooked me on, man. It was that was more action than Shakur Stevenson. Jarvis, 5 seconds scene, bam, lands a left hook right on the pecker of B-Dave, and B-Dave goes down. And, I thought it was a good fight, entertaining fight, you know, back and forth action. Kind of expected a little bit more of B-Dave, but Jarvis, you know, he showed he came back from the loss, got a knockdown, showed some power, and then just showed some dog in there against another, you know, little pit bull with in B Dave.
Yeah.
I think it was a good showing, good performance. You know, he showed they're gonna bring him back again. He's a champion now,
mm-hmm.
so they're gonna bring him back and get some defenses. Yeah, I was pleased with the fight.
I'm kind of surprised that you said you were expecting a lot more from B Dave. B Dave, he's mostly yes, he's a boxer, but I think he's just kind of a tag team boxer. I think he really depends on the back and forth action. He needs timeouts and stuff like that. What I was disappointed was actually in Jarvis. You know, just the quality of sparring, the having a training camp over there at the Mayweather gym. He's definitely getting a lot of good experience fighting against guys who have a lot more experience than him. I know Carmel, the new protege of Mayweather, he's gotten some rounds with him. I would assume that he would have stopped B-Dave just based off experience and stuff like that. Plus, it was B-Dave's first fight. I think he was a lot more drained fighting in a smaller weight class. I feel like Jarvis should have ate him up. Like, within that first round, he should have stopped him. First round or two.
Well, I mean, I personally don't think so. I think you're right, though. B-Dave definitely is. I think he showed he's more of a tag teamer because he does need a little bit of time to recharge his little spurts.
Yeah.
But once he starts throwing, he starts throwing.
That's what
I like about him.
Yeah, he gets down.
Yeah, I actually agree with you about the aspect that I expected a bit more from Jarvis. You know, he got the win. That's good. That's important. He's now the new champion. He can call shots now. He cements himself as a guy who many people want to see. But the style that he brings is very, very beatable, in my opinion. He was calling out Slim. Mm. And now listen, if B-Dave was able to smack you, he hit you hard. You got caught a lot. If Slim catches you with that right hand, it's going to be a nights out. I do not believe Jarvis has the adequate skills to beat a big name like Slim or any other big name, because he is way too hittable. He's just a one gear type fighter for me. He has the pressure, he has the volume, but that's all he brings. If you bring a different gear to him, he will struggle, and if you hit hard, you will hurt him. And that's what I saw throughout this fight. B-Dave was catching him with good shots, hard shots, and well, B-Dave is B-Dave, right? I was not expecting very much from him. In fact, he performed better than what I was expecting. My expectations were exceeded by his performance on Friday. But he is not on the level that Jarvis is at. And I was expecting Jarvis to kind of stop him in the later rounds. And I feel Jarvis let him off the hook too many times. And didn't apply, you know, a lot of the things that I was expecting to see from him. Which gives me right back, which kind of proves my thinking of I believe that Jarvis would be beaten by any other smarter, higher level fighter.
Yeah, he doesn't really, like you said, he is kind of like a one shift type of guy. And he also sometimes gets a little too, what's the word?
Overconfident.
Kind of, like, a little too eager in there. Like, when he knocked down B Dave, he couldn't really land anything after the first round. Like, he was missing a lot of punches. And I was like, get some range, buddy. Like, you got to get closer. You know, you got to set it up. You can't just, like, start throwing, like, a lot of punches that are just missing. You know, so I think he definitely has a lot of stuff to work on. And I think with that, with the Mayweather thing, I think it's a bit of a, like a lie or something. Like, yeah, he probably gets good sparring in there. But I don't think does he have a good trainer? Does he have people that are going over game plan with him? Does he have people that are, like, molding him and molding his regular assets to what maybe he likes to do and making them better and better and better?
I would say so. At a big gym like that, there's different...
I don't care about you. Especially the Mayweather gym, bro.
I mean, I would say because he's bringing something to the table, I guess. You know, he's been there for quite a while now. I think maybe he's had maybe another training camp as well, but he's been there for a minute now. I remember even last year when he sparred Floyd? Mm-hmm. Yeah, so he's been there for at least minimum like a year, going somewhat consistently, getting, and it shows when you spar a guy, fight a guy who's really good, and then you spar or fight a guy that's not the best or like half of the level of what you're typically accustomed to, you do notice a difference. You do kind of excel, or you should excel almost in a sense.
The thing with that is like, at his level, he shouldn't be fighting, sparring guys like Carmel or Mayweather. That's not really going to be beneficial to him. Because no one that he's going to fight is going to fight like a Carmel or a Mayweather. Like, when he sparred Carmel, they gave him a handicap of, like, Carmel can only throw jabs, I think.
Mm.
Like, is that really beneficial for you? Maybe in the cardio aspect, yes. And maybe in, like, the mental aspect of, like, I'm fighting, like, a really good guy. But like, in the game plan aspect of, like, molding a plan, you know, that you're working on in training camp, and then you're going to apply it to the fight. It's just, I feel like it's a bit, you know, it's a bit unnecessary.
Yeah, I understand. But, I mean, I didn't know about that. But, I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if that was a thing. Like, they only told him to use a jab.
Yeah, I'm pretty
but
sure.
I have seen other clips of him actually going at it. Like, him and someone else of, you know, like, three pro fights or whatever, actually getting, like, down and dirty, actually, like, brawling it out. So, I feel like in that aspect, that should sum up, like, add definitely, you know, experience to just your fight game and stuff like that. You should be able to translate or correlate that over to a guy like B. Dave.
I believe, I do think they do come up with a game plan for him, but his lack of experience fighting and being in the ring, I don't think he's able to apply it during the fight. Mm. I think he just lacks the experience of being able to apply what he's learned or what they went over for the game plan into an actual fight. Which is why I always see, based on, you know, he last fought against Anderson Gibb. The performance he put against Gibb and Jarvis and B-Dave, to me, seems quite similar. It seemed like the same Jarvis. No change at all. They just expect him to just go in there and just pressure him and just, you know, just try to bully him. Just. That's all he does. That's all he really is. But I believe they have some type of game plan, but Jarvis is just not able to apply it into the fight.
Yeah, he does really. Maybe. Kind of does the same stuff. You know, he didn't really change. He's just like a.
He's still an amateur. Yeah, well, I think we're being real too critical. Yeah,
obviously,
he's. Yeah.
You know, like, he's not going to be. That's another thing. Like, yeah, he's an amateur. Like, he's not going to gain the experience, like, that quickly sparring a Mayweather. You know what I'm saying? Like, he needs a more focused approach, I think, especially when you're an amateur, because he's barely learning. You know, he's barely learning.
Yeah, I guess that could make sense. And, you know, also it could be, you know, first time fighting for a title. So I could also have, you know, the nerves or whatever. But, yeah, it's interesting to see what how he goes out. I mean, I don't think I want to see him go up against Slim. I think we kind of know how that's going to go. Maybe Nick Lamau.
Well, he called out Nick Lamau and Wasabi in the post-fight interview. So
I think we could see a Nick Lamau. I think Wasabi is really keen in on Deji.
Yeah, I think the Jarvis versus Nick Lamau. Actually, I think that would be a good fight because B-Dave and Nick Lamau have, like, I guess, like, a little beef or something like that going on. Oh, they've had it going on for a bit now. So, with B-Dave, you know, taking the loss, Nick Lamau called out Jarvis, also saying, like, oh, like, something along the lines of, like, you know, I'll avenge you or something like that. Which, you know, it'd be a whole little funny, I guess, story arc. You know how influencer boxing is. So, it'd be kind of funny to see that. But, honestly, that fight would be a lot better because I believe Nick Lamau is a better fighter than B-Dave. So, he'd pose more of a threat for Jarvis. And, you know, people already rate Nick Lamau very highly. Just mainly because of his Jace Wingler performance when he made his debut. So, you know, if I was Jarvis, I'd be looking at my options and I would try to pinpoint the guy who would get me the most, you know,
respect,
right? Which would be Nick Lamau, you know, who's, you know, a guy people already respect. And if you beat him, people are going to say, like, oh, like, he's beatable too. So it's a very calculated risk that he could take and it would, you know, be more beneficial for him than fighting against a guy like Slim who, you know, you could get sparked out. Yeah, so if I was Jarvis, I'd be looking at my options. Mainly, I'd be trying to go for not maybe a Salt Poppy or even a Slim, but go against someone other of these guys who are near B-Dave's level, a bit higher, and just try to build up like that.
Yeah, I think, yeah, if if Jarvis is smart, you know, he's stay far, far away from Slim. You know, Slim is no joke. Also, Slim is bigger than him as well, so I don't even know what weight that would be at. Anyway, yeah, I think a Nick Lamau would be calculated risk, you know, where you can excel.
I think so. If he wants to continue to do box and take this a little bit more serious, then yeah, Nick Lamau. And then from there on, depending on how he looks, move on to maybe tougher fights and stuff like that. If If I'm not mistaken, who is around his weight class? Is Salt Poppy now around his weight class?
Salt Poppy is heavier.
Heavier.
Yeah, Salt Poppy's like 168. Yeah. A lot. Yeah. AT is like one. AT ranges from. He can fight like a cruiserweight all the way down to like 160. AT, yeah, he ranges everywhere. Okay. But, no, I mean, what's his name? Jarvis fought Anison Gibb at, I believe, 168 when they had a fight. Yeah. I'm not sure why they had him. Why he decided to fight at 155. Maybe he believes he's stronger.
Yeah.
Even though I did not see a big difference in him. Regardless of that, Jarvis, he's still young. He just made his Misfit debut. He just became one of Misfit's new fighters. Yeah. And people are going to want to see him because he just, you know, action.
Got that aim assist.
He really do, right? He do got the aim assist. So, yeah, I'd be very interested to see what path he partakes in next. But there is one fight I really want to talk about. Fight coming up this weekend. We have the super middleweight showdown between David Benavidez versus what's his name?
Bobo.
Andrade. I forgot his first name.
Hey, I don't remember his
name. I forgot his
Demetrius.
First. Demetrius, there you go. David Benavidez versus Demetrius Andrade. November 25th, showdown for the super middleweight belt. With an interim or something?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it's interim.
Pretty sure it's interim, yeah. So, what are your guys' predictions about this fight? It's coming up. What are your guys' thoughts about it?
Man, I don't think Bobo is as scary as everyone says he is. Yes, he is awkward. Yes, he does have some unique features about him. Like, you know, he's a world champion. You got to get there. If you get there, you have something to you. I'm not taking that away from him. But the Mexican monster is the real deal. He showed in his last fight against Caleb Plant that he can do it all. He is fine with maybe letting the first 2-3 rounds go. But once he starts landing, he starts landing. And those punches are hard. So my prediction is a clear victory for Benavidez. If not a late stoppage. You know, I think Benavidez, the longer this goes, the more it benefits him. Because his engine starts revving up and he starts getting more comfortable in there. His opponent starts getting tired. And he's able to just land some crazy hard barrages. So, I got money on Benavidez.
Yeah, I got my money's too is on Benavidez. But what's interesting is that I don't think a lot of people are saying, and it's just people on Twitter. A lot of people on Twitter be saying that he's scared and stuff like that. But I don't think he's scared. You know, I think he does pose some threat to Benavidez. You know, he can't go blow for blow. But he could definitely punch in between. And he's a tricky southpaw as well. You know what I'm saying? He's got decent height. And he's a big dude as well. He's got speed as well. But I really think that his timing and trying to punch in between the fights. And he's got somewhat decent power. I think could pose somewhat of a threat. We have seen Benavidez on the ground. But I don't know. We'll have to see. But for me, yeah, I'm going to ride with Benavidez.
Well, Bubba's going up in weight.
He is going up in weight.
First time at 168 against the biggest 168 ever, I feel like. You know, Benavidez is a big boy. You see him in his offseason, he gets heavy. So, tough fight for him, you know, size-wise.
Yeah, size-wise, yes. But I think he, like, just his body, I don't think it's, like, of a slim, small flame. He's kind of a thick boy, too, you know what I'm saying? I'm not quite sure how you would make 160, cause just being that big. At 160, I think we're definitely going to see the best version of Bobo. I think he's definitely the stage, the lights, is going to be big, it's going to be bright, and I think he's definitely going to try to shine.
Yeah, this is also a perfect opportunity for him to get the respect from the boxing community, because no one likes Bobo. I feel like I'm under the impression no one really likes him. No one really pays attention to him.
I'll be honest. I don't like him. I don't respect him.
Yeah. That's the thing. He's been calling for big fights. He's been saying, oh, everyone's ducking me, this and that. Yet his resume is dry. So this is his first and maybe his only shot at a big showdown, and it's against the Mexican monster. So if anything, he has everything to gain. You know, he needs this fight in order to maybe even potentially get a Canelo fight in the future. You know, because he's been calling out Canelo, and that's where the whole payday, payday, you want payday meme came from, because of him. So if I was Andrade, I do everything to get myself, you know, fully situated, get myself worked, you know, have a good camp, and try to showcase my skills. Because even if he does lose, but if he's able to do something on Benavidez, he's going to come out with, like, you know, some a lot of respect from the boxing community, something that he's never received ever in his career. Yeah. And he's already at the back foot of his career. He's in his, you know, 30, 34. He's at that age already where a lot of these boxers, you know, their prime is either done or coming to an end. So for him, this is a, you know, this is his one and only shot, I believe.
Yeah, it's a make or break moment for him. You know, he's never had that ever in his career. So if he better make the best out of it, because if he doesn't, he's not going to get another one.
Yeah, this might be the last time we ever see Bobo
in the ring. Imagine he gets knocked out in like four rounds. He is never getting another world championship title. Nowhere. He is not getting a Canelo Alvarez, man.
Yeah, so it's interesting to see. Yeah, we all got Benavidez. Anyone else on the card that you guys are kind of excited to see?
Yeah.
Matias. No, Subriel Matias, 140, monster. He's the real boogeyman at 140. He's one of my favorite fighters to watch because he's just always action-packed, hard-hitting. His record displays how hard he hits. Every win that he's gotten has ended in a knockout. And this man is no joke. He's a world champion, and he's had the chance to showcase on the pay-per-view stage on the Benavidez card who he really is. And I believe him and Benavidez are going to be the stars of the night.
The whole undercard, I'm excited to see. I'm excited to see Hector Luis Garcia, who's opening. I'm excited to see Matias, like you said, a very, very exciting fighter and champion at 140. And I'm also excited to see the Benavidez Sr. and Charlo. I think Junior. Which is the older brother of Benavidez, even though he's smaller, which is kind of funny. I'm excited for every single one of those fights. I think that Showtime is leaving us with a bang, man. You know, they dropped the All Access, RIP to All Access. You know, I always remember you. They're dropping their final pay-per-view event, and they're going all out. I think they got a very stacked undercard, very stacked card, and I'm expected to be entertained through every single fight.
Yeah, actually, I completely forgot about the co-main event. Yeah, for sure. They're definitely going to get down and dirty. We haven't seen Charlo. The co-main event. Yeah, we haven't seen that Charlo in the ring for a long minute now. And you know how Jose Jr. be getting down to it. You know what I'm saying? He's a comb forward type of fighter. Reminds me of Michael Carbajal, who's also from Arizona and stuff. So, yeah, it's going to be stacked, and what better way for it to be on Thanksgiving?
Thanksgiving weekend, baby.
Yeah.
We're eating good. We're watching the fight.
Watching fights as well. I think, if I remember correctly, there's not a lot of big boxing events around, like, Thanksgiving weekend. This is, like, the first time that I can remember.
I mean, which boxer would want that, man? You don't get to eat a turkey. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, like, I feel like that'd be the worst, man. You're just watching your whole family indulge while you're like
eating. And your final week of weight cut.
You're most depleted and they're like stuffing their face in. Oh my God.
You know, drinking some booze, you know, having a good time, being thankful.
Like, bro. Like, I can't eat. Yeah, that'd be the worst.
Regardless, we have that to look forward to. So, next episode, we will be talking about the outcome of that entire last Showtime pay-per-view event. I believe we covered everything.
Yeah.
You guys believe so? All right. Don't forget to follow us on social media. We are on X, TikTok, Instagram, and don't forget to subscribe here on YouTube. Comment down below your prediction for the David Benavidez fight. Is he going to win by decision? Is he going to win by knockout? Is Bobo?
It's the same thing.
Is Bobo going to pull off the upset? What are you guys' thoughts about Shakur Stevenson? Is he really the real deal, or is he just, you know, a runner? Don't forget to follow us on our Discord. The link is down below. We upload episodes every Monday. And so this was Pablo.
This is Rudo.
This is Asael.
And this was the Last Round Podcast. Thank you.